In the past century, humanity has made unprecedented advances in science and technology. Cars were invented, astronauts landed on the moon, and we can now find mating partners by swiping right. But progresses in technology have not only favored us, human pollution and climate change are currently threatening our planet. But there is hope. Scientists are trying to combat plastic pollution or CO2 emissions by genetically modified organisms. And with that, my name is Kevin Steinig, and today we'll talk about synthetic biology, directed evolution, and how we can change microorganisms to fight man-made disasters. But first, a short disclaimer. In this episode, we will talk about GMOs or genetically modified organisms. I know that this topic can be controversial to some. However, we will not talk about genetically modified organisms which are sold to supermarkets, but only about microorganisms which are found in laboratories. So, let's start by discussing plastic-eating microorganisms. Plastic is a term which describes a group of different synthetic polymers. Polymer means that plastic consists of many repetitive units called monomers which are linked to each other. And these linkages make plastics very stable, which is the good and bad thing. This and the fact that most organisms cannot digest plastic mean that it can remain in the environment for centuries. But is it true that no microorganism can digest plastic? Can we digest plastic? No, although we have detectable amounts of microplastic in our blood and our organs. Yeah. But there are in fact microorganisms which are able to digest microplastics. A few years ago, Japanese scientists were looking for microorganisms which can digest PET, a form of plastic. They identified a mysterious microorganism called Ideonella sakaiensis, which seemed to feast on PET. Later, they noted that this organism contains a protein called PETase, which can break down PET. It is estimated that one colony of this bacterium can degrade one plastic bottle in 6 weeks. Although this protein is quite astonishing, it is not enough to break down the 6 billion tons of plastic which are currently found in the environment. The scientists, however, recognized how revolutionary PETase could be and therefore they tried to make it more efficient. Here they applied a process called directed evolution. You might all remember evolution from school. Evolution means that all organisms slightly change over time by acquiring slight changes in their genetic information and subsequent selection. Directed evolution now is a similar process, however, it is controlled by scientists in a laboratory. The main idea is, instead of changing whole organisms, that we change proteins such as PETase over and over again until they become more efficient in performing certain tasks. So in the case of PETase, they changed the protein numerous times until it became much more efficient in degrading plastic. But as always in science, the story does not end here. Besides PETase, other proteins have been identified which can break down PET. Recently, a team of scientists compared the different PET digesting proteins and they found that a protein called LCC is 33 times more efficient in degrading PET compared to any other proteins. And then again, they applied directed evolution in order to make this protein even more efficient. In this manner, they created a version of LCC which is able to destroy over 200 grams of PET within 24 hours using 3 milligrams protein per gram PET. And in other, more understandable words, they were able to make it 10,000 times more efficient. But there are still over 6 billion tons of plastic in the environment and scientists are just trying to figure out how they can apply this technology on a larger scale. Moreover, there's also another drawback. This enzyme is only able to digest PET. If dyes or other plastics are present, then the enzyme will not be very efficient. Moreover, if we decide to make this protein in microorganisms, then there's always a danger that these organisms might escape the laboratory. And it is not clear what impact such microorganisms would have on the environment. So let's see how this technology turns out. So now that we have uncovered what could be at least one potential solution for human-made disasters, let's tackle another one. So, which one should we choose? Maybe a bit of mass extinction? Or how about some nuclear waste which has been dumped into the sea? We have done a lot. Let's go for CO2 emissions this time. We might be able to lower CO2 emissions by applying synthetic biology. In the example before, we have learned that in order to solve a problem, we only need to take a closer look into nature. Do you maybe know any other organism which is able to take up CO2 and convert it to something else? Some organisms which maybe haven't planned to do that. These organisms normally stick together. Yeah, we are of course talking about plants, and I hope that all of these plant puns do not make you leave. Plants, algae, and some microorganisms are so-called autotrophs, meaning that they can take up simple substances such as CO2 and water in order to make sugars. They have a set of genes which enable them to have a unique form of metabolism called photosynthesis. We, like animals and most other organisms, are so-called heterotrophs, meaning that we do not have this pathway and depend on autotrophs. This, however, might soon change. Scientists are trying to find out if we can change heterotrophic organisms such as fungi or bacteria in order to become autotrophs. In principle, we take the genes which are necessary to perform photosynthesis and insert them into microorganisms. In this manner, we could cultivate them in large scales in order to reduce CO2 emissions. So what we try to do here is that we genetically engineer bacteria or fungi in order to get the metabolism of plants. Sounds unbelievable? Well, some scientists have shown that this is in fact possible. In fact, the most famous microorganism in the history of science, called Escherichia coli, has been modified to make organic matter out of CO2. And this could have huge implications if we want to make organic molecules out of CO2. However, this kind of technology is still not very efficient, and only time will tell if it will find applications. There are many other ways in which scientists try to reduce human-made waste and slow down climate change. And although climate change and pollution are the two greatest threats we face in our modern times, I really believe that innovative research might be able to solve these issues. And with that, I also want to pass down a question to you. What do you think of synthetic biology and changing proteins in order to remove plastic pollution, for example? Let me know in the comment section, and feel free to leave a like if you enjoyed this episode, and subscribe and hit the bell button if you're new here in order to stay informed about the latest discoveries in life sciences. And with that, I'll see ya.